That's no moon. That's a battle station. Though if it were a battle station the size of a small moon, it still might not have enough gravity to make working inside of it not a gigantic pain in the poorly fitting plastic armor. Does the Death Star need anti-gravity technology, or can we use science to redesign it? Twitterer at BulldogComet15 recently asked me, follow me on Twitter and Instagram, is the Death Star big enough to generate its own gravity? Well, that's a good question. We've known for decades that the Death Star is a massive weapon, but in Rogue One, it looks even more massive because of perspective. Is that massive enough, though, to generate gravity such that it makes walking along its interior floors feel normal? Let's find out. First of all, how much gravity does the Death Star need? Well, I know that technically everyone in the Star Wars universe is an alien, but they are humanoids that don't exactly bounce around when they walk, so let's assume a normal 1G gravity at the Death Star's surface. Surface gravity is what we refer to when we're talking about how much you'd weigh on Mars or the moon, and it can be calculated from just a few variables. Where little g is the acceleration due to gravity, big G is Newton's gravitational constant, big M is the mass of that object, and R is the radius of that object squared. For example, if we plug the gravitational constant into this equation with Earth's mass and Earth's radius, then we get a gravitational acceleration of 9.81 meters per second squared. This is how fast we are accelerating downward towards the Earth, and the force you feel pressing up on your feet is weight. Weight is the Earth catching you. Now we have to check if the Death Star has enough mass to create that weight. Time for some assumptions. The Death Star, at least the first one, has a diameter of 140 kilometers. And I'm also gonna assume it's made out of something like steel with a density equal to 7.8 grams per cubic centimeter. But it's not a solid steel sphere, so let's guess that maybe 60% of it is for the infrastructure, leaving the other 40% for battle station operations. Then we apply the surface gravity equation, and we find that the surface gravity on the Death Star is around 0.092 meters per second per second. This is 100 times less than the gravity we have on Earth. Unless the Death Star could be 100,000 times more massive than this conservative estimate, no, Bulldog Comet 15, the Death Star is not big enough to generate its own gravity and needs artificial gravity. The mass method doesn't work with the design of the Death Star either. As this great video from Minute Physics shows, as you get closer to the center of the Death Star, the mass decreases faster than the force of gravity increases, meaning that there's no point inside of this station in our example that gives you a decent 1G. If the Death Star needs artificial gravity, is there some non-fictional way to do that? Well, actually, you surprise lightsaber! The easiest way to create gravity in space is to spin people around, like in the spaceship from The Martian or 2001 A Space Odyssey. No, really. Imagine a stormtrooper standing on the inside of the Death Star. If the Death Star is spinning, he will have a velocity that looks like this. And if that velocity traces out a circle, then more importantly, he will have an acceleration that looks like this, pointing inwards. This acceleration, combined with the stormtrooper's mass, creates a virtual force called the centrifugal force. If the Death Star is spinning such that it can create an acceleration of 1G, then this centrifugal force should give the stormtrooper the same weight as he would have if he were standing on the surface of a planet. So, let's figure out how fast the Death Star would have to spin to create this kind of artificial gravity. We want the acceleration component to be 9.81 meters per second squared, or 1G, and the radius squared is 70 kilometers, which is 140 kilometers of the diameter, divided by 2. Then we can solve for the velocity component here, which should be 830 meters per second. And if we know how far around the Death Star is, then we can get an RPM of 0.1. That's totally doable. So, if the Death Star could spin at a very plausible 0.1 RPM, then it would have enough artificial gravity. Wait, this is wrong. That kind of artificial gravity only works if people are standing on the inside of spheres. The Death Star is designed wrong. Oh, we gotta go back. Gotta go back. We all assume that the Death Star is laid out like this, with horizontal floors, but that can't possibly be right. It has to be easier to spin the whole structure slowly than power floor-by-floor anti-gravity technology, and the Death Star has to spin to target stuff. So the Death Star has to be laid out like this, a central core with dozens of increasingly larger spheres inside a giant shell. That makes sense. Let's check the math. If we want a livable range of G-forces, let's assume that the outside shell, where no one is, has 1.5 Gs. Then, according to the math, the closer you get to the core of the space station, you have around 50 kilometers of workable, livable G-forces. This is the majority of the station. Think about it. The blueprints that we see in the movies are never very clear about the interior structure of the Death Star. The math checks out, and the Death Star is large enough that you wouldn't notice the curvature of the floors. Yes, what I'm saying is, in every Star Wars movie you've ever seen, whenever you saw someone standing on the Death Star, they could have been upside down, feet planted on rotating, curved floors. So, because the Death Star needs artificial gravity and spinning the giant structure would be the simplest option, we have all been wrong about the structure of this famous weapon for nearly 40 years. It would actually be a series of interconnected spheres spun in such a way that the centrifugal force would provide the same kind of weight that you would feel on a planet. Or, we are looking too closely at a fantasy story. Still, I think it is worthwhile to challenge your assumptions, fantasy or not.
Because science. Where am I going?
Thank you so much for watching. If you're still not with me on this, think of it this way. Even if you did have some kind of artificial gravity technology, it would all be pointing towards the center of the Death Star. And if you had horizontal floors, that means people on the outside, nearest the outside of space, their force of gravity would be different than if you were standing closer to the center. So rotating the whole structure makes the most sense. Science for the win. This week, we're giving a special thanks to one of our favorite shows, Ash vs. Evil Dead, on Stars. See, the gang from Ash sent us two chainsaws, a metric ton of blood, not technically accurate, and a bunch of everyday items for Jess and Dan to destroy live on the internets. You can watch all the mayhem over on Nerdist.com, and even better, you can catch episodes of Ash vs. Evil Dead on the Stars app or on demand right now. Groovy. Look, okay, I get that the Empire destroyed probably billions of people when it blew up Alderaan, but for a rebellion and Jedis that are supposed to be peaceful and stuff, when Luke blew up the Death Star, according to Wikipedia, the Death Star had around 1.7 million people working on it. What percentage of those people do you think were just doing their jobs? Just, I gotta go to work sweeping up all the crushed droids out here on this battle state. I had 6 months left before I was gonna retire and go back to my family on Coruscant. All of those people, Luke killed them. Who's evil now? Star Wars.